thing was catching the sound, and then yeah, there was a big echo, but now. Yeah, we're trying now to do this, yeah, so I'm trying to remove the color lights. I don't like color lights.
Oh, wow.
And
I didn't know we could do that. And then with the...
And is there a way to remove a little bit, like to have more on top, to remove this shadow or not?
The shadow from his head.
So if there is, yeah.
Covers the keyboard, so it's like a back somewhere.
I think it's this one.
Oh yeah, it's
probably
that
this
spot
one.
Here.
Yeah. So if we don't have that, let's see if it's too dark.
Still there.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, can you come up to the mic and tell me anything you want to change?
Oh, this mic?
Yes.
So yeah, is there a way to... remove or minimize that light that's...
Yeah, the one
that's
light that's...
I can see my hand right on the keyboard.
So just turn it down?
Or off if possible.
Off or down? Yeah, let's see.
Yeah, because it's distracting to hear, to see his head on the keys reflected from the back. Still there. Probably not that light, or else to cover it. I've never seen this.
I think it's that one there, that strong one there, no?
Yeah, there is a spot behind.
That's it, yeah. So that's better now, so let's see if we can now focus
more
on the front, on the top.
They confuse you when you...
Ah, okay.
And maybe if you want to grab them.
Mm-hmm. One, two, three. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Make sure.
It's not on. Is it on? I
well,
don't know.
It said go to the mic.
One, two, three. Can
but
you hear
it's
me?
Not on.
It's not on. Uh-huh.
We can press and hold.
So left or mute.
If this mic works, now it works. Didn't want the apron, right?
What's the apron? What's that?
Apron would be colored lights.
Ah, yeah, no, yeah, I prefer not. Yeah.
This is not bad, but oh.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great, no shape, but it's kind of dark, right? So if you can just somehow enhance maybe those, I don't know. Because definitely I need more on the page and more here.
Under the spots. Yeah, it's hard to see the music with this.
Oh, okay.
Oh, wow.
That's good.
Those are great. And no shadow.
And no shadow. Yeah, perfect. Yeah.
That was magic. That was a
long
magic.
Like that?
Yeah, that's perfect. Because now it's light here and very, yeah, almost no shade. That's good. Yeah.
Okay.
Perfect. Yeah, that's good. Let's
this
leave it like
golden.
So, yeah, set up that. And what do I do with this microphone? So, when
they can turn it off.
Yeah, can you turn it off when I'm not talking?
Yes.
Because I'm going to speak between pieces.
Yep.
So I'm going to come, play the first piece, no speak, I don't speak, and then I will speak a little bit between pieces. So I will just maybe come here, and I may not even take the microphone, I probably just speak
into it.
Like this. Is that enough?
Yeah.
And how about, is that live stream, right?
Yes, we'll have a stream. It goes
then probably we don't need that chair. So if the
you
microphone is here, so now if we are having the microphone there, then yeah, no chair. And I have my stuff here. So when I'm speaking, it's okay if I just go here, so then I don't have to deal with now removing the.
Did you need anything else?
No, I'm done. So is that a good location for me to speak?
Yeah, that's perfect. Just don't go any further that way.
Okay, so the microphone will be here, and I'm not even going to take the microphone. I'll just go here, I speak a little bit, and then I go back to the piano.
Perfect.
Okay.
And there's no break, right?
And I'm not going
to... the intermission?
No, I won't. I changed my mind.
Okay.
Yeah. So I will cut the intermission, okay? So we'll just go through the program, and I will be speaking between.
Okay, sounds great. Thank you.
Which means I will come and introduce you and say that there's no intermission.
That's a good idea, yeah.
We're streamlined.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're streamlined. It's because, I'm a little bit worried about the drive. The drive, yeah.
Может, они волноваться, но интермиссион поможет.
Потому что с ним 10-15 минут, да. И будет тяжеловато, но не очень. Вот программа сама, по-моему, музыка, где-то час.
Mm-hmm.
Чистая музыка.
Плюс,
с комментариями, ну, я даже могу час 30 делать, но и могу поменьше. Иногда я делаю слишком много комментариев. Я сегодня попробую делать чуть поменьше, чтобы уложиться в полтора часа нормально, да? До 4:30, да? Или даже меньше можно.
Можно меньше,
да?
Окей. Можно, мы думали про час или час 15 с комментариями. Если без интермиссии.
Okay. this music performed live. Okay, I'm here. And how about in recordings? No? Okay, some recordings. Okay, cool. Okay. So it seems that I have some work to do. Okay? This is great music. And I was actually with you, Paul, a couple of years ago, because I didn't know his music. And I've been playing the piano for 45 years, so it's really surprising to me when I discovered this music. And it was just like something clicked and something told me I just have to do it. I have to perform this music. It's great music, it deserves to be performed. And so that's how it started. It was a classic case of thinking first and acting first and thinking later, because once I got excited about it, I called Naxos, I said, let's do a host B of this music, and they said, yes, let's do it, and then I got the scores. And then I thought, okay, I'm in for a wild ride. Those pieces can be very hard and can be very demanding. These two pieces, they were composed separately, but they were published together. These are the earliest pieces from his output. The Caprice, the second piece I performed, was his first piece. He was 18 years old when he composed that, and then he added the Prelude to that. So these are from the 40s, and I decided to put together this program decade by decade. We will skip the 90s because he didn't compose any piano music in the 90s. But we will decade by decade. So these are the pieces from the 40s when he was still studying and doing his undergraduate degrees. Now we continue in the 50s when he composed two of his piano sonatas, number one and number two. And I'm going to perform the second movement of sonata number one, which was also published separately as variations on a Kentucky folk song. So I'm going to play that separately from the sonata because the sonata is too large and I wanted to put other pieces in this program. And Walker himself performed and recorded this movement as a separate piece. So I think it's good to do that. And I believe the reason was because that movement is so beautiful and it really deserves to be performed separately and is more approachable for the audience and for the performance as well. So I will continue now with continue with another piece from the 50s, the second sonata. This sonata he composed as his graduation work for the Doctor of Musical Arts at Eastman School of Music. And this was a proposition from the professor to write a piece that explored the power of intervallic relationships. So the piece is heavily dependent on the interval of a third. And it's really well written, as everything that Victoria Walker did. It's a very precise composer. Nothing is random. Everything has a reason. Every note, every accent, every articulation. And he was a master of the theme and variations, as you could see from these beautiful set of variations. And the sonata number two starts with the theme and variations, very short, very concise. The entire sonata is only 10 minutes and it has 4 movements. So the movements are very short. It's a theme and variations in the first movement, and scherzo, allegro in the second, a very dramatic and beautiful adagio in the third movement, and then the fourth movement has a little bit of everything, and at the very end, actually, it brings back the theme from the first movement. So I hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
and he gave us three back piano pieces, one as a smaller piece that had a decade. But the two main pieces from the 70s are Spektra and the Sonata number 2. So I'm going to play both side by side right away. So you can, I think they really have lots in common. Now we are moving away completely from time signatures. So until now, the scores still have some time signatures, even though Spatials changes quite often. And but from now on, from Spektra all the way to his last piano music, no time signature. That means that the pianist has to look at the score and just follow the pose, certain pose, and you just, each measure is going to be its own universe. And that's what creates this sense of complete freedom, even though every single note, every single rest, every single pedal is well put on the score and is well prepared for by the performer. But the effect to the audience is a very free piece, almost improvisatory. In the 70s, he was already teaching at Rutgers University, where he stayed until his retirement. And he was very famous and traveling a lot. And in one of his grants that he got to travel to Europe, he was in Italy. And that's when these two pieces were composed. But particularly the Sonata number 3 was composed during a time when he was in a village in Italy at the lake of Como, Lac de Como, and he said in his autobiography that from his window there was a church, and that church had a very beautiful bell, and it rang a lot. So it was initially really fun, and then it got annoying because he couldn't compose. I mean, he could, but it was always that bell. So the second sonata, in a way, was his way of getting rid of the bell. And that's the second movement of the sonata. It's a really unique movement. It's one single chord repeated 14 times. And it's repeated with different lengths of time, different dynamics, and with one whole pedal. So when we get to the second movement of sonata number 3, I would like for you to really focus, close your eyes, and see if you can get that idea of the bell sound. It's a very interesting experience, both for the performer and for the audience. And I think the reverb of this hall and this great piano is going to be very interesting for that movement. In the third movement of that sonata, he uses a technique that's very, very George Walker's. I think one of his signatures is when he uses long notes together with staccato notes at the same time. So you have a chord and then one note keeps sounding and other notes are staccato. So that creates a polyphonic texture, very interesting, and it plays around with the harmonics of the instrument. So I hope you enjoy Spektra, followed by Sonata number 3. The title is a typo from Walker. He liked to do things like that with his title. Sometimes he would use an old spelling or just a flat out wrong spelling. So the spectra in this piece is with a K, means the spectrum of light, with a C. And his goal with this piece was to display through the keyboard all the possibilities that light could come, if you imagine light going to a prism. So he uses lots of dissonances, sevenths, ninths, seconds, and combine them or contrast them with perfect consonances, like a fifth, like an octave, or like a unison. Lots of repeated notes and tremolos to create this sense of shimmering quality of
the Spektra.
Thank you.
I chose to do the other piece. was an Italian monk in the medieval times, and he created this way of teaching sight singing or solfège using the left hand and a series of designs for the notes. So if you look online, Guido's Guidonian hand, if you look at that, you see that picture. And I'm telling this because I think it is related to the way this suite is built, not only because it's five pieces or five fingers, of course, but the idea of the Guidonian hand is some sort of vertical, not vertical, circular, and what's the word I'm looking for?
Spiral.
Spiral, yeah. So it's a circular, but it's not a complete circle, it's a spiral that keeps going bigger. So I think that you recognize that in the pieces. In the very first one is a short piece that has this musical idea of a spiral, and then the second is a very virtuosic piece, very angular, lots of intervals, staccato versus legato. The third one explores the similar ideas as the third sonata with the low notes and the staccato notes at the same time, and always going back to that circular spiral idea. The fourth movement is a little bit different. It's inspired by a song by Duke Ellington. Duke Ellington was also born in Washington, D.C., same as George Walker. And George Walker always felt very passionate about Duke Ellington's music. The quotes, when he uses Duke Ellington's tunes, the quotes are not very obvious. I think this one is fairly recognizable. The tune is Satin Doll. So if those of you who know Duke Ellington, you may recognize the tune within that. But it's not very, very obvious. And the last piece in the cycle, again, brings back that spiral idea, and to complete the cycle, actually ends almost in the way that the cycle started. So I think this is a really cool suite, five pieces, with this hand.
Thank you. Thank you.
to get to the last piece of the program is last piece for piano, and last sonata and last piece for piano composed in 2003. And in a way, this is a compilation of everything he did. You will hear many of the sound effects and the soundscapes, as I call them, that we heard throughout this recital. It's a very short piece, about 5 minutes, but this is a sonata, so we do have all the elements of sonata. We have separate themes, different themes. We have a development, we have a sense of recapitulation. You recognize the initial theme coming back at the end. So it's a really well-written sonata, but extremely concise. And that is the piece that started all. That was the first piece I heard and really caught my attention. And from that piece, all this project developed. I'd like to take the opportunity to thank Dr. Tutunov, my old friend and dear friend, for so many years, for inviting me to present this year for you. And I hope you enjoy Sonata No. 5 by George Walker. Then finally I realized that he composed 9 songs for voice and piano, and what he did on that recording was simply he played the voice and the piano together, making a solo piano piece. So I decided to do that as well. And to make things more interesting, the poem is by George Walker himself. So I'd like to read quickly the poem. The title is Living, and it goes like, "We were standing in the rain when you whispered my name. As you murmured a sigh, I heard you say goodbye. I must have seemed surprised as I looked into your eyes. The tears began to flow as it turned to go. This could not be the end. We were more than friends. We met on the street, and after a week, we knew then for sure our love was complete. So we'll set our steps apart, and I will leave with aching heart, knowing that I wish to die when I hear you say goodbye." So this is Living by George Walker.